explosive dancing, I give you John Mirrione.
The other thing that empowered me is I took the martial arts and I got involved in breakdancing. That was beyond amazing experience for me. I was actually at a party and I saw somebody get up and they did this incredible dance, and I saw the girls were all into this boy, and I said, I don't know how I'm going to do it, but I'm going to learn that because I want to do that, right? So I started watching TV and watching these shows on TV like Star Search and Dance Fever, and I'm like picking up moves here and there. I created an act of my own, went into a talent show. I won in that talent show.
What year was that?
This was in the 1980s, that'd be 1984. So, you know, I started to, and then I went to Vegas to visit my mother, who was all fully rehabbed. She'd been fully rehabbed for a long time. And she took me to a top nightclub in Las Vegas, and I took second place in this big dance event. I was 17. And so I was like, you know, I wanted to go in the military, and I wanted to go in the Air Force. And I said, you know, Bob Hope, Elvis Presley, these were military entertainers. You know, I'd be interested to see if they would let me be in the military, and I could just entertain the troops and just dance, right? So I go to my recruiter, and my recruiter says, so, you know, what is it you want to do? I said, I would love to dance. He stopped. He was like, probably something he's never heard. He says, well, they have this elite outfit. You have to train to go in this particular showcase. But you have to, like, he says, you have to compete and win first place each time. Otherwise, you're not even on this road trip, this amazing road trip, where you get to see the country, you see the world. I said, I'm signing up, right? So I was willing to, like, do the crapshoot, go in the Air Force, give my life up for my country so I could dance, right? So I go into basic training. And I'm standing on guard duty. It's 3 o'clock in the morning. And the drill sergeant comes up to me. He pictures African American, big guy. He's standing there. He's looking down. And he says, Airman, he says, what job are you here for? And I'm standing, I'm like, sir, want to be Air Force entertainer, sir. Entertainment? What kind of entertaining are you doing, right? I said, sir, dance. It's 3 o'clock in the morning. He says, get in my office, right? Because he didn't believe I could dance, right? So he was trying to figure me out. He gets a boombox, the time they had the big radios, puts it on the desk. He said, dance. So I get out there, and I'm doing this whole dance routine, and I'm, you know, spinning, jumping, splits, all that great fun stuff, right? He clicks, he goes, well, all right, sit down. He says, let me tell you what you got to do. You got to go to your first military base, you got to win first place. Then you're going to go to your second one, first place. This is what you got to do. And the next day, this is in Lackland, Texas. I'm standing at attention. I figure it's like 100 degrees outside. And I had shaved, like we're bald with the hats, and we're standing there. He comes out with the boombox. And I look, I'm like, you got to be kidding me. So I'm just standing there. Airman Mirrione, front and center. Yes, sir. He said, order to entertain the troops. I'm like, yes, sir. So I get out, and I'm dancing. And you see all these soldiers are trying not to laugh. They're like, what is going on? And I'm just doing this whole breakdance martial arts routine. He said, Airman Mirrione. He told me to stop. He said, back in line. Yes, sir. I get back in line. So this is all during basic training. So we're on a bus in basic training, and I'm with one of my colleagues, and we're, you know, I see a sign. Now, the military base in Lackland was divided boot camp, and then you had active duty. So I look at the sign where it's on the other side. I'm like, oh, there's a big breakdance competition. And the kid, this friend of mine's, he's like, we can't go there. He said, we'll be peeling potatoes. They'll lock us up. I said, but look at the time. I said, it's when we have break. He says, John, I'm not. He said, you're crazy. There's no way that I'm going. I said, I'm not asking you. I'm going. You could stay. I'm going. I'm going to compete. During that break time, it was like a week or two later, I remember the exact time. I leave. I sneak out of boot camp. This other kid follows me because he's like deep inside. He would have wanted to do it too, or he wanted to see what I was going to do. I go to the other side of the base. They had already started the competition. I submitted my name. I'm watching these kids spin on their heads and do all this, you know, amazing stuff. I won first place. put my hat on. I went back to the other side of the base. No one ever found out, but I did it. And then when I finally got, we finished boot camp and I went to this other base. It was a Pease Air Force Base in New Hampshire. Went to that competition, won first place talent show, right? I got letters from colonels, generals. These people were now following. They became like fans. It was the craziest thing. They're like following me to my shows. I'm not just doing that there. They'll have a dinner. Can John Mirrione come? I want him to dance at this dinner. And I'm dancing there and I'm doing. And then I go to my next base, I'm competing. I go to Barksdale, Louisiana. I compete there first place. Then I went on a tour, 6 weeks around the country. But you had to go to a boot camp to go on the tour. It was a 3-day boot camp where they did not allow you to sleep at all. No sleep allowed, coffee and soda all night. And you had a woman screaming at you, telling you how pathetic you looked while you were on stage, and that if you do it like that, they're gonna send you back home. So it was like a whole breakdown of the person. They build you up to set you up for that 6 weeks of like literally hardly any sleep. You're in a hotel for 3 days and you're back out entertaining. But it was absolutely incredible to be treated like, I was treated like a celebrity. And it was, it built my spirit and my soul. So I end up traveling from New Hampshire 6 hours to Harlem, almost in your neck of the woods, right?
Yeah.
I go in. And there's a line coming outside the Black Music Theater. So I'm standing on line, and I'm the only Caucasian standing there. And I'm like, it's getting dark out, and I'm still in the back of the line. I'm like, why am I still in the back of the line? Because they kept cutting me, and cutting me, and cutting me. And before I left, all my African-American friends said, you're crazy. I don't know who you think you are. They're not even gonna let you in. I packed out of my car, and I drove back to New Hampshire. They said, see, we told you weren't going to get there. Why did you listen to us? All that traveling? I was mad for about a year. I said, you know, I got to go back. And it was interesting because the person that I spoke to before I left the military was African American. He said to me, you know, you did great in your career. I did all these other jobs. I was a building manager of 120 people. I was one of the other jobs that I did. He says, but John, if I was in those dance shoes, I'd get out. I'd get out if I was in your shoes. I got out. And I went back to the Apollo, right? So I drive all the way back, go back on that line again, and there it goes again. They're going up front, going up front. I took my radio, I had a boom box, and I just walked right in front of the line. I cut the whole line. And I literally, you know, I took a risk of my own life to do that, right? And I never forget, it was a guy named Ralph Cooper Sr. He was the founder of Amateur Night at the Apollo, the original. He's passed away. He's a legend. I love him for what he did. And he said, who are you? I said, I'm John Mirrione. I came here to dance. Get it over with. So I move back and I go click. And I start moving. And I'm flips and splits and spinning kicks. And I look at the people's faces. They go, and they look up. And they all start screaming and cheering and going crazy. And the music stopped playing. And I kept dancing. And then Ralph Cooper Sr. said, that's enough, stop. And I went and sat down. And I'm thinking, you know, why is he so upset with me? I thought, maybe because I'm pretty good at this stuff, right? He said, come over here. I'm like, what? He said, you're going on amateur night at the Apollo next week, Wednesday night. Be there. I said, yes, sir. Thank you so much. I leave. I come back the next week. This time I'm on stage. I bring the boombox. I'm like, you know what? I'm not going to let them see my face at first. Let me cover my face with the boombox. So I strut across the stage, and the crowd's going crazy. They're like, they see the footwork. It's, you know. And as soon as I turn, I hear cheers and boos, cheers and boos. And they're like fighting with each other. And then Sandman, this guy comes out and dragged me right off the stage, basically saying that, you know, you're not good enough. That's kind of like their gimmick. Well, I was upset. Another year goes by. I'm still working on that routine. I said, it was like a sickness. I got to go back. It's like the boxers got to go back in the ring again. But I won. I won in a lot of ways. I go back. I audition. I go back and it's amateur night again. We're putting you on Showtime at the Apollo. You're going to be on television worldwide. I'm like, yes. So then I go on to the TV version, right? So I go back, and you know, you have to rub this tree stump, and it's Sinbad, famous comedian. So that being said, there was a struggle getting on the stage.
Hey, show the folks what you can do, man. Let's go get busy, Mr. John Mirrione.
Sandman again, and I'm doing all this acrobatic, it didn't matter. It was fighting, boos and cheers. Sandman comes out, pulls me off the stage again. Well, another year goes by. I'm like, I'm gonna get this crowd. I said, they're not even gonna know it's me. This time I come up with an act that glows in the dark called Neon City. New York City in the backdrop, there was a cardboard my uncle had created with New York City, and then my ex-wife like painted it in colors that would, when lights hit it, would glow. And my outfit was all glow in the dark, with a baseball cap with these big balloon pants and tic-tac-toe outfit, all like colors. So I get out there, there's black lights. I start dancing, they're just going crazy because the lights and the dance and the music, they're like, this is great. They loved it. And someone put the house lights on. And they looked and they go, boo. But it was too late because the act was over. I never saw Sandman. And I won in myself because I had to overcome the adversity. So they built my character. There were those that loved me, those that they didn't. It didn't matter because I loved me. And it gave me the courage to do anything I wanted. So even when I've traveled like with the Harmony Power Foundation, mission statement, stand up to bullying, stand for human equality. You can see I stood up for bullying, stood up to against bullying, and I stood for human equality. By me going to the Apollo Theater stage, I'm standing for human equality. I'm like, no, we are the same. I love you. I want you to love me.